Hey everyone, thanks for tuning in to Power Athlete Radio. There's no doubt about it, humans have had a huge impact on our planet's diverse ecosystems. We are selfish sons of bitches whose primary goal has always been to streamline our struggle for survival. Well, we nailed that, and now it's time to get responsible with how we sustain our existence. According to Bobby Gill of Savory Institute, practicing regenerative agriculture promotes the health of the animals that we consume, and when the animals are living their best life, they in turn promote the health of all of the flora and the fauna in the surrounding area. Bobby throws a ton of data our way, making it impossible not to look at how you've been voting with your dollar at the local grocery store. And if that's not enough new information, Tex's idea for hard lard may just be the next hot paleo cocktail. That's right, combine your favorite animal fat with preferred liquor and you've got yourself a hard lard crowd pleaser. I can barely say it, hard lard crowd pleaser. Hard lard crowd pleaser. Bacon grease and tequila, anyone? Here's episode 316.
The, what our local coffee shop calls, the Tex McQuilkin. It's a decaf soy latte, 3 pumps vanilla.
It's a chai oat milk latte.
Mm-hmm. So that's option one. Option two, of course, is to wear women's keds. Option three is both. And guess what we have here today, folks, on another episode of the Premier Podcast in Strength and Conditioning. This is Power Athlete Radio, brought to you by Women's Keds Vans. I'm a co-host, Luke. Tex is giggling like his soy latte.
Well, you know, when you drink that many soy lattes, you tend to giggle like a young girl.
And ladies and gentlemen, that's the voice of John Welbourn, not to be confused with Jean Welbourn. You know what I tried to get the other day when we were at Fort Hood working with that guy with the, what were you calling, Stretch?
Yeah.
I was trying to get like a side by side and like click where I could Photoshop your face on him and be like, I found Jean Welbourn, because this fucking guy was 6'6", 150 pounds.
He claimed to be 165, but he wasn't. No way.
No way, dude. And I'm like, man, that would be a great, like, didn't get it though.
Yeah. I don't know his name. And when he tried to tell me, I was like, no, I'm not going to remember it. Your name is Stretch.
Yeah. You are Stretch. We will see you soon.
Yeah. I told him, I was like, man, I'm going to need you to put on at least 100 pounds by the next time I see you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He's like, I eat all the time. I eat at McDonald's 4 times a day. I'm like, I want you to get a big bottle of olive oil and a shot glass. And every meal, you got to do a shot of olive oil. Is he going to do it? Probably not.
But would it work? Probably. Yeah. I think what I tell him, I'm like, you need to fucking squat and deadlift every day and eat a porterhouse. I think that'll get you in a good spot.
I told him, if you ate McDonald's 3 times a day and you drank a gallon of whole milk and did a shot of olive oil with every meal, you'd probably be okay.
I mean, you gain weight. I'm not sure how your gut would hold up.
Well, he's probably in the army. He's probably used to eating some like awful stuff. So he's probably not like us with these, you know, tender guts.
Yeah.
Speaking of guts, did you guys get your gut biome test done?
So I got a scoop today. I just had, man, I haven't had time or didn't make time to, you know, poop and scoop.
Like pooping, you just poop in your hand.
Poop and scoop. Yeah, it's called the poop and scoop.
Yeah.
Well, my plan was just to shit on the office floor. And, you know, gives me plenty of room to scoop.
I do have it with me, though. Who shit on the floor?
You shit in the fryer. So it's longevity, right? I think the longevity group is who Thorne is working with. We, as some of our listeners probably know, and folks have been in the symposium, Thorne supported the shit that we've done. Actually, we have a coupon code we can distribute. I don't know why we don't talk about it, but if you just put power in at checkout on Thorne, I think you get 10% off. Yeah. Power.
Cool.
All uppercase, maybe all lowercase. I can't remember. But we got linked up with them at SummerStrong. Mm-hmm. They just kicked off a group called Longevity, who's like going to vertically integrate this at-home testing kit process that I guess is like a new popular thing. And the first one they started with was the gut biome deal. And they take like this, I was reading about it. There's like the 16S testing protocol that people tend to use now. They're doing this like multi-level shotgun analysis that gets you down to like the nitty gritty. And that's what's in their product. So they hooked us up. We're going to do a gut biome comparison.
Yep. Live on a podcast.
And like, so I think there's three categories here. There's one, obviously, Healthy Gut Biome Award probably goes to the guy over here who's been paying attention for the past decade while Tex and I were in fucking college drinking. You were drinking Natural Light. I was drinking Keystone Light.
Jenny Light from Geneseo, New York.
That sounds awful.
And $8 a 30 pack.
Welburn's over here drinking Hard Lards. More on that later, people. Stay tuned.
I just saw Inky, Tom Inklet, on, and I did a 3-day stool test with him, too, that I'm going to run in parallel. And it was funny because on Instagram, I posted a picture of the longevity. And some guy was like, you know, tried to like give me this like, oh, you know, it all comes down to analysis and the people, you know, isn't very good. And my comment was like, man, maybe you just need better friends. And of course, he's like, well, are you saying that Lane Norton and John Berardi and who else, the other guy, Andy Gliffin or Galpin, you know, aren't, you know, smart? And I was like, dude. First of all, they're nutrition guys and one's an exercise physiologist.
And stop having heroes.
And stop having heroes.
Yeah.
Two, you obviously didn't list Inklet on in there because if anybody that understands the gut biome as it relates to like cancer and all this other stuff, I mean, he's pretty much either he's the guy or knows the guy. I mean, he sent me all the research the dude did on like the bacteria for the mouth and the tongue. And I'm saying this on the podcast. Don't fucking email asking for me to send it to you. So I'm just putting that out there.
Don't do it. But we're going to do healthiest gut biome. We're going to do most fungi, pathogens, and viruses in the gut. And then there's a third one, I think. So we all have a chance to win.
Most Modelo.
I hope.
There's unusual.
I kind of hope that like everything's wrong with me because then I could be like, oh, man. I wasn't able to hit that weight today. You know, I got this gut biome issue.
Ooh, good one.
I've been looking, you know, I'm looking for a crutch. The problem is they're going to be like, your gut's perfect. And I'll be like, fuck.
Well, after we did the jaw alignments with Dr. Greg, he's like, man, Tex, yours is perfect. So I have no excuse to why my numbers are not as great as y'all's. And
maybe it's those Lego feet and those women's shoes.
But the jaw, perfect.
Did he say perfect?
Yes. Said one of the best he's ever seen.
Well, that doesn't mean perfect. I mean, he sees a lot of schlubs.
He's blind, isn't he?
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to know if you had that perfect jaw structure, why weren't you able to go heavier on the RDLs today?
I did my best. My gut biome.
That's what I'm secretly hoping. And then some dude on there was like, oh, look out for that H. pylori. And I'm like, oh, God. That's
my H. pylori sucks, too.
Yeah, no, the H. pylori is a... I can't remember exactly what it is, but I know that when I researched the H. pylori, it had to do with like, was it microplasmic pneumonia? There was a bunch of weird shit. So when that guy put that in, I'm like, oh, that ain't good.
So I'm eager to see what that all fucking shakes out to be.
Yeah.
But what were we actually talking about? Oh.
Symposium.
This episode's brought to you by the Power Athlete Symposium, people. If you want to have a super fun time with a whole bunch of healthy gut biomes, head to Austin, Texas, December 5, 6, 7. That's a Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Hey, why is 6 afraid of 7?
7, 8, 9.
Yeah, 7, 8, 9.
Yeah, everyone knows that. Did you know that?
Nice belt.
No, that's what 0 said to 8.
Oh.
Mm. Tex, if you're going to eat all those kid snacks, you have to at least know some kid jokes.
Yeah. So I tried to arm my daughters with like two jokes that they could always remember that are funny regardless of your age.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, those were it.
Back on the symposium, people, last year, the year prior, since we've been in Texas, we've had to scale back the practical session to only a small group of attendees. This year, everybody attending the Power Athlete Symposium will have access to multiple practical sessions.
Ooh.
What?
Mm-hmm. Boom.
Mind blown, bitches.
Sonic boom.
Yeah.
Boom.
Yeah. We are currently in process of selecting speakers. Keep your eyes peeled on social media or head to events.powerathletehq.com/symposium. And there you can see all the information as it's released. You can sign up for email updates. People, it is unlike Power Athlete to come in and do something any less better than the previous year.
I was going to say it's not within our guidelines to do something that's not better than it was the year before.
You show up and you do better than yesterday. It's just that simple. This year's going to be fucking sweet. So get in early. We have a little early bird special. You sign up early. There's limited tickets there, people. There's limited tickets. You sign up early. You get a free swag pack. And once that's gone, it's gone. We'll have a bunch of merch at the shop or at the event. You can always get that stuff there. We're going to have awesome sponsors. They're going to be kicking in. We're going to have great speakers. It's going to be epic. Heart of Downtown, December 5th, 6th, and 7th. Events.powerathletehq.com/symposium. Go there and make it happen. Now, if anyone has ever wondered what hard lard is.
Oh, yeah.
Do we have an episode for you?
I thought that was where you know, guys would pour liquor in Texas belly button and slurp it out. Isn't that hard lard?
No, that's man, I wish I was prepared for that. I could come up with something, but I don't have it.
I thought that there would that was
that's
actually
a fuzzy
a, there was actually something in the in like the Naperville mafia.
Oh, bro shot?
Yeah. Bro shot. Lay down. I need you to cup your belly button a little so I can get a big one.
Yeah, bro shot. Yeah. A fuzzy navel.
Yeah, like you slurp it out of a belly button. Tevis, lay down. You got a big belly.
No, ladies and gentlemen, we have gone so far off the track of what our guests came to talk about. Your fucking heads are going to explode.
A couple of times.
Like three times. And the great part is we just stopped. He's like, so here's what we were talking about. And then it's great. Bobby Gill's on the show. Yeah. Tex, you know Bobby from back in the day.
Yeah, I've known Bobby for about 10 years, man. He's had quite a journey, but it's all about quality meat as long as I've known him. So we make.
So what's he spending time with you for? Quality meat.
He was a member of Cali and I's gym, and we did our damnedest to talk him off the ultra marathon train, but then eventually his body caught up with him.
And he just did it.
I totally forgot that Cali was there, so that's how he was imitating Cali, and I was like, man, do you just know her from? Like the podcast, like all like the, you know, the street people in Seattle that know Cali from
on the street wire,
on the street wire. Like, you know, they got these burner phones and like, hey, Hinsman's on the Power Athlete Radio. Jump on that shit.
Yeah. But eventually he took my training advice like 4 years later, hopped on Field Strong when we dropped that. And now he's back, but he's doing cool things. He started Cupid Undie Run. So anyone that's ever done that, you know who Bobby is, but he's moved on and taken his talents
Cupid Undie Run.
Yeah, it's kind of a big deal across America. But anyway, so he took his talents to Savory Institute, and he's doing a lot of things, working and connecting and just all the back-end stuff, but he's incredibly knowledgeable about all the cool processes that are in place to empower farmers.
Yeah, it's all about regenerative agriculture. So you're going to learn a shitload about that and hopefully change your perspective on shit. And then when you go to the market, you look for some shit.
Well, you know how you do the regenerative agriculture. It involves shit.
Actually, that's a pun.
So it's
a lot of poo talk so far.
Yeah, that's good. We got a lot of gut biome. We got a lot of poop, dung. We got a lot of stuff.
So let's learn about some dung. Let's learn about hard lard. And let's learn about regenerative agriculture with old Bobby Gill. What do you say?
Let's do it.
Go.
Go.
Unique New York.
All right, I think we're good
how
to go.
How now, brown cow? How now, brown cow?
Red leather, yellow leather. The arsonist had oddly shaped feet.
The human torch was denied a bank loan.
Red leather, yellow leather.
Unique New York. Did we already say that one?
Yeah. Unique New York.
Come
unique
on, Luke. New York.
Well, like my, I'm like Memento. Like do you my remember, short-term memory
do you remember
is
what
minutes.
Movie that's from?
Yeah, Ace Ventura.
What, you mean?
Anchorman. How dare you, sir? How dare you? And then there's Anchorman 2, where the only line I remember is like,
go fuck you.
No, at the network news, we shit standing up. And he's like, what? And then it was just a 2-second pause and then scene cut. I thought that was the best fucking
line. My favorite line is when he looks at him and he just goes, and go fuck yourself, San Diego. Like, and he's like,
let's never talk about Anchorman 2 ever again. Thank you.
Okay, we can manage
any of it.
I kind of blocked it out.
So let's, God damn it, 800 numbers keep calling me. Got to put this on snooze. All right, we're technically live, so we can talk about whatever we want. And by live, I do mean not live, but recording.
Perfect.
So Bobby, what's cooking, man?
Hey guys, good to be here. All right.
Well, you're technically not here, you're there. But you know,
he's kind of here in spirit. Like he's like, it's like the royal
week. He has been here.
Yes.
So
I have.
He hasn't always been there.
I passed through once.
That's right.
I was there, like a year and a half ago? I was coming through to Paleo FX and Tex showed me around.
Yeah. No, that was over a year ago because it wasn't the Paleo Nerd Fest pretty recently.
No, well, I think 2 years ago, or like the two events ago.
Yeah, it was a year plus because it was just recently.
Year and a half.
Yeah.
Paleo Nerd Fest, aren't you a Paleo FX alumni?
No, I refuse to speak.
You've never spoke at Paleo Effects?
No, I was supposed to speak at the inaugural one, and I didn't because...
Oh, and I'm thinking ancestral health symposium.
They asked me to speak, but the dude, one, didn't want to pay for my room, didn't want to pay for my ticket, and wanted me to like buy like a booth. I was like, huh, how about no?
Yeah, I hear you. I'm going to not contribute to that conversation, I guess, because we had a booth there this year, and it was actually really helpful. A lot of the folks that came through around to our booth. Actually, we had a presidential candidate, Tim Ryan from Ohio. He's one of the million Democrats running for president, but he was walking around the trade show floor and he stopped by the Savory Institute booth and actually had some really good chats with him. He called me the other night to talk some communication strategy stuff. He's a big supporter of regenerative agriculture.
Oh, nice.
So that's kind of cool to see presidents talking regenerative ag finally.
No, it's long overdue. I mean, I got embroiled. Like I purposely don't do this, but I got embroiled in like two arguments on Facebook recently. One of them has to do with square bodies, where this guy was shitting on NV4500s.
Don't you talk meat or trucks? Fucking
basically,
Instagram people.
When it comes down to like square bodies, this guy was like, the NV4500, you know, this. And I'm like, are you out of your mind? Like, I have those in multiple trucks. We have them in multiple trucks. And like, the guy was an idiot. The other one was this guy tried to, I posted something and he's like, you know, the way they treat animals on ranches and farms, and like went through like this total, you know, typical straw man vegan argument about how, you know, you guys raise animals and somehow all the ranchers do nothing but abuse these animals, which kind of blows my mind, seeing is that the ranchers raise these animals and these are their cash crop, and that bringing in the healthiest, strongest, you know, best animals possible increases their cash flow. But there's this weird narrative where people think like that, you know, that ranchers and farmers are just abusing these animals left and right. And, you know, this is systematic abuse of animals. And then I thought he was fucking around, because his next comment had to do with, you know, the animal production contributing to methane, which was destroying the environment. And at that point I was like, either you're a moron or this is a fucking, you're a troll, because there were three times as many ruminants on this planet pre-Columbian era, especially in North America. And on top of it, like I've been to the ranches. When you go out and you visit the ranches, the animals are well taken care of, because this is how these guys make their money. That's like us saying, hey, you know what? We're going to write extremely shitty programs just because we're these fucking awful people. And it just doesn't make any sense. Like, wouldn't it make sense to like raise like the best animal you could to like take them to market and like produce the most so they provide the most?
You can also take that a step further. It's not just about providing the animal that you're raising with the best life possible. You know, they're going to have an absolutely perfect life every day until their last, at the very last second. And then they're going to go out quick. They're not going to know what happened. So it's a total stress-free life. But when those animals are properly managed, what they're doing is they're creating a better ecosystem. Those ecosystems provide habitat for more than just the livestock that live on that land. I mean, there's deer and fauna and snakes and rats and mice and ground nesting birds and all sorts of other animals that depend on our grassland ecosystems. And so the ranchers who are raising these animals the right way by practicing regenerative agriculture, they're not just doing the right thing for those animals and for their own businesses. They're doing the right thing for that ecosystem on the whole and all of the other life that depends on it. And the important thing is that grazing animals are the only type of animal that can sustain health of that ecosystem. They are the tool for cycling those nutrients back into the soil, for making sure that the grasses are thriving and sequestering carbon out of the atmosphere down below. Like, that's the only way you can do that is with a ruminant animal who can digest the cellulose of the grass and turn that energy that we have an infinite amount coming from the sun, turn that into calories that we can ultimately use and use that as a tool for regenerating the ecosystem. If you take those animals off the land, the landscape is going to die. Sure. The grasses turn brown and oxidize, and that prevents other new grasses from growing. You eventually get all the grasses dying off, and then you get bare ground. Bare ground is bad because it erodes away. It leaches carbon out into the atmosphere. It eliminates the habitat for all these other animals. Like the reductionist mindset of farmers and ranchers are only doing this for their own business and only doing it to make money, and they don't care about the environment, I think is an argument that it needs to go. Oh, farmers and ranchers are the only stewards of the environment that we can have for grasslands, which represent 1/3 of the Earth's surface.
So Bobby, for our listeners here, you know, the ones who don't often call upon the term sequestering and talk about cellulose, like what compare and contrast the two approaches that we're talking about for folks, and then, you know, dig into what y'all are doing.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So like, think back to what the planet looked like before humans came along and screwed everything up. Like, let's look at North America.
Flat, nice and flat.
Oh yeah. The flat earth. Go on, Bobby.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Well,
The fact that you believe in flat earth,
I believe in flat earth.
Well, I think secretly you believe in flat earth. I just think that you're afraid to really come forward because you know that we'll just beat you to death with that bottle.
And I can't believe that you believe that he thinks that you believe that he believes that you believe in the flat earth.
Wait a minute. That's one too many beliefs. Like, here's the part that hurts my brain on the flat earth, right? Like, not to go off on a tangent, but like, the fact that every one of their arguments are these like elaborate conspiracy arguments that were like, there was a dude like 3,000 years ago that had two obelisks that basically figured out the circumference of the earth. And like the guy was using like obelisks to do this thing like thousands of years ago, and they knew about it. Like the Sumerians knew the earth was round. Like it's unreal. Like I'm just
shills.
No, I just wonder if it's like a really, really bad joke that like has just gone too far. And then the problem is, it's kind of like, I know you guys don't know this, but there was this deal called SenCal, and it started in Central California. And what it was where these guys were putting spacers on the wheels of their trucks and like spacing them out real far. Mm-hmm. And they were, I think they did it as a joke. And then a bunch of hillbillies from like Florida, North Carolina, and all over the South down here thought it looked real cool. So they get these like 26-inch like wheels on lifted trucks and they stick out real far. And it looks awful. And whenever I see it, I'm like, you guys know it was a joke and you guys took it too far. It's kind of like the flat earth. Like it was a bunch of people like Ken Ford fucking around telling jokes, and then a bunch of fucking honestly like knuckle dragging morons got into it.
My wheels stick out too, so I'm twofer on this.
Yeah, but your wheels don't stick out for that reason. You didn't put wide. Yeah, they're just wide.
So Bobby, anyway, we'll come back in. So before we fucked everything up, go ahead.
Regardless of whether the earth was flat or round, what we do know for sure is that, you know, like North America, there used to be 75 million bison roaming across the continent.
Now that was, what year was that? I know that it was like, you know, the US Army was instituted to like take down the red man, you know, the American Indian. So
before colonialization, we had approximately 75 million bison roaming North America based on the estimates that people are able to say.
Well, you've seen the pictures, right? Of the buffalo hunters, sitting on skulls that are 30 feet in the air.
So that 75 million eventually got dropped down to less than 1,000. And so that was due to, you know, lots of hunting of the bison, you know, intentionally by colonialists trying to, you know, suppress the livelihoods of the native populations here in North America, but also disease transmission, drought. It was multifactorial. It wasn't just the hunting. But if you look back to when we did have those 75 million roaming across the continent, they also had predators. Gray wolves being the main one, but there are others. And essentially, those predators would keep the bison tightly bunched and herded, and they would regularly move from one piece of land to the next. You know, so they're trampling the grasses down, they're grazing the grass, they're fertilizing the land with their urine and their dung. And because they don't want to stand around in their own shit, they move along to the next piece of grass. They wait until the urine and the dung has fully reincorporated, and then the grasses have regrown, and then the root structures down below have regrown back to health, and then eventually they make their way back to that same piece of land. So they had these ancestral migratory patterns that kept the land healthy. It kept the land thriving and cycling, you know, periodization essentially.
How badass are buffalo? They are, buffalo are my, like, if I, like, people, somebody asked me once recently, they're like, oh, do you have a spirit animal? I'm like, yeah, buffalo. I fucking love buffalo. They are, like, when we got a chance to go out to Rome Ranch and see them, like, not only are they, like, the coolest, most majestic looking animals, if they sense any weakness in their herd, they just fucking kill it. Like I remember saw, like, one had, like, a huge gaping wound. I'm like, you gonna do anything? They're like, no, they just kind of heal. And if they don't, the other buffalo just stomp them to death because they're weak. I'm like, God damn it, I love these things.
Yeah, you look at a lot of farming and you get farmers and ranchers that are out there like having to help in the delivery of calves and, you know, all these other things. Bison are extremely wild still. You can't get that close to them. You're not assisting in the birthing at all. Like they're going to do their thing. And in doing so, only the strong survive. And so they're going to naturally cull out those weaker genetics. And so you're just going to have, you know, natural strong genetics by letting nature do its thing. But towards nature letting nature do its thing, you know, the problem being is that, you know, when we had those 75 million bison and the predators that gave the proper amount of pressure so that we got the right behavior and movements out of those animals, well, the problem is that we've killed off most of the predators now, and we've domesticated most of the grazers. And we also have put up cities and roads and all these other sort of things. So we can't just let nature do its thing. We need to have animals still grazing in tightly bunched herds and regularly moving around the landscape. But they're not going to do that on their own because the conditions in the society that we live in today doesn't allow for that. So as farmers and ranchers, the problem that we see is what most folks do is they just set their animals out to pasture in what's called continuous grazing or set stock grazing. So they put them out to pasture, they leave them there for, you know, the entire year, whatever period of time it is, until they want to, you know, wrangle them up and go sell them off at auction. The problem there is they're not tightly bunched and herded and moving around. So they're going to be selective of the types of grasses that they're eating. So they're going to overgraze their favorites and they're going to undergraze their least favorites. And ultimately what that's doing is it's killing off both of those species. So they're being selective in what they eat, and that's killing off the grasses, and the land doesn't have time to rest. You know, after you, I mean, you know, it's important in looking and working out. You know, you have that hormetic stressor that comes across, and then you have the recovery period afterwards, and that's when you get stronger. It's the same thing with the land. You come in with an intensive grazing session, and then you need to have adequate recovery afterwards before you hit it with another intensive grazing. So what we do at the Savory Institute as a nonprofit is we train farmers and ranchers how to get that type of behavior and impact out of the animals that they have on their land. And so it's not rocket science, but really what it is we as humans can act as the predator, as the gray wolf that comes in, and through portable electric fencing, we can contain the animals into a smaller space, get that herd effect, and then plan their movements so that they don't come back to that same pasture until those grasses have fully regrown. And so really it's just, it takes a little bit of planning and you bunch them up and move them around, and it's really all it takes.
You know, you were here at the ranch at my place, was like we said, over a year ago. And since then my neighbor has about 50 horses. I think they got 55 horses, and we'll let the horses come in and actually graze in our pastures. And it takes them about 2 days to kill the main pasture in front of our house. So they eat every blade of grass. They stomp on it. They shit their brains out. And then they go back. And then I bring them in. I push them into the second pasture. And the hilarious part is the amount of birds that are going through and tearing through through the horse shit is unreal. Mm-hmm. Like there's hundreds of birds. Like, and they land. They tear it all up. Like it's pretty amazing to see the ecosystem, and then they eat every blade of grass, and then I pushed them into the far one. They ate every blade there, and then I put them out, and it's been about a week and a half, and all of a sudden the grass exploded back. And like my wife's like, we got to go cut it again. Birds, I'm like, or we bring them in.
Yeah. The birds are an interesting piece because they're going in and by looking, you know, they're going in trying to get bugs and whatnot. But what that does is it spreads that that dung around, and it also reduces the parasitic load that you otherwise would have. And so the birds working in conjunction, that symbiotic relationship with grazing animals, it helps reduce parasitic load and, you know, kind of sterilize the land and makes it healthier in general.
Yeah, it's unreal. Like, I mean, it just rained last night, and I swear it grew like 2 inches overnight. And it's
that's
pretty
awesome.
Well, yeah, it's super interesting here. And you know, Texas, like I was telling these guys, like every single day we live here in Texas, like something weird happens where I'm like, man, that's like, I was telling these guys today, we have these little Phoebe birds that make nests on like random places. And there's some vents that come out on the top, like right underneath our like overhang. And it's probably 15 feet off of the ground. There's just like these little vents for when the heater comes out. And the Phoebes have made a nest on it like every year we've been here. And then every year I go kind of knock down once they leave and clean it. And then they come back. Today, my kids always go out and they like to see the birds and then we can see the baby birds. I go out and I take a look. I'm like, what is that? And I realize it's a snake. A snake, it somehow, I don't know if it climbed the wall, if it came on the roof and kind of like, I mean, it's got to be an 18, 20 inch overhang, somehow weaseled its way and was in the nest on top, like 20 feet up. And I'm like, oh, and the kids are having a heart, like freaking out, like the snake's eating the birds. So I knocked it down. It did. It ate all the birds. But like, that's like Texas is crazy. Like I've never seen anything like this place.
I mean, you'd be surprised when you start treating the land how it wants to be treated. Wildlife just comes back in all sorts of different forms. Like we've got a savory hub down in Georgia. It's this guy, Will Harris at White Oak Pastures that some folks may have heard about. I know like Radio Lab did an episode about him and he's had some videos. He's kind of a big deal, but his whole deal was he was a traditional, you know, conventional farmer. He was feeding his animals grain, you know, doing his thing down in Georgia. He realized that it wasn't cutting it. You know, he had four employees. They were all making minimum wage. They were all barely getting by. He switched to holistic management, to planning his grazing. Now he has 10 different types of animals that he raises. He has like 160 employees who make double the county average. He's just crushing it in terms of like what his soil organic matter looks like, just like the health of his land, the microclimates, all this other stuff. But the piece that I find really interesting is back in the day, bald eagles, you never saw them. They didn't exist around there. Now he's got over 100 bald eagles that live on his property because the ecosystem he has built is just so beautiful and so conducive towards life that they've figured out like, hey guys, this farm over here is dope. Like we should come live over here. So now he's got 100 bald eagles living on his land and they're basically feeding off of his chickens and his turkeys. Like bald eagles will swoop down, grab two chickens with their claws and fly away. And so he estimates that he's losing in poultry profits probably around $250,000 a year based on what the eagles are eating.
Oh, Jesus. We have a huge barn owl here on our property that he shows up around dusk. And he when he extends out his wings, I mean, they have to be 6 feet per wing. And this huge thing, it just goes down and he dive bombs and picks out little rodents out of our, out of the pastures. And he'll just dive bomb me. I see him snatch up a little rodent. He kind of flies away. And then I'll see him like 20 minutes later. And he just literally kills everything. It's pretty amazing. Like when you start seeing things like that, you're like, what is that? Is that a I didn't even realize what it was at first until I saw it perched. And then when I saw it put out its wings, I'm like, so to see a bald eagle actually do it. I mean, there's probably some government subsidy where they're like, well, you can't hunt bald eagles. Probably just send us the bill.
Yeah. So yeah, the USDA, they have a reimbursement program for any loss of wildlife, any loss of your livestock to wildlife. The problem is the assumptions that they put into those calculations are based off of conventional farming practices. So for him with poultry, you know, he's got, I want to say like 75,000 birds that he's raising a year out on his land, all 100% out on pasture. You know, USDA expects 75,000 birds to be penned up in some big ass coop that's disgusting and you have to wear a hazmat suit to go inside of that maybe has a small little door so that you can classify it as free range, but they can't really walk because they're so breast heavy that they're not going outside anyways. So your losses to natural predators are going to be minimal. So they've got a cap at, you know, like a couple thousand bucks, I want to say, you know, maybe like 4,000, 7,000, something like that. So Will, when he had his bald eagle issue, he went to the USDA and he was like, hey, I'm losing like $250,000 a year. This $4,000 that you're paying me in losses ain't cutting it. And they're like, sorry, that's just the way it is. So like the system is set up to favor large agribusiness. All of our farming systems that exist are in favor of large agribusiness.
Why is that? I mean, is it just the lobby, or is it just the fact the way that it was done for so long? So like that's how people were raised. So the government kind of acquiesced instead of realizing that like, hey, the conventional farming is probably destroying the land.
I think lobbying is a big part of it in, you know, on the behest of large agribusiness coming through and, you know, trying to push policies through like at slaughtering facilities. A slaughtering facility, you have to have a USDA inspector on site at all times. You know, if you're a small guy and you've got like a couple animals, you can't afford to pay that salary of a USDA inspector. So then you can't afford to have your own plant. So therefore, you got to pay for a time slot at the big guy's plant. And so they're going to jack up their prices and they're going to make you jump through hoops. And so only if you're a big guy who has the volume to move through those large processing facilities will it make sense for you on an economic scale. And so that's where you see some of the, you know, the differences. Like you go to the store to buy a pound of grass-fed beef and you're like, damn, this thing's $10 a pound. I could just buy this grain-fed beef that's only like $3 a pound. Well, it's like, yeah, the grass-fed guy is paying more for his processing. He's also not fattening his animals really quickly by pumping them full of grain. And that grain, by the way, has been highly subsidized because that's what we do for commodity crops here in the US. So like the economic model is very skewed just based on the way a lot of the laws and policies have come about in this country. If you look at places like Australia, they don't have commodity subsidies. They don't have the corn production, the soy production like we have in the States. So consequently, almost all of their beef is 100% grass-fed, grass-finished. It's just not a question.
That's because in Australia, all they do is have is land. I mean, I think the total population of Australia is smaller than LA County. It's like 10 million people.
Traveling to Australia and Ireland, it's funny to see like on the steakhouse menu, grain fed, and it's more expensive. It's crazy.
Yeah, dude, yeah. We saw that in Australia. But yeah, I remember when I looked at the total population, and I looked at the total population of Australia based upon they were talking about gun control. That, you know, Australia like was able to, you know, put a buyback program together, and they had that mass shooting, and they outlawed all weapons, and it was such a seamless process. And I'm like, for 10.5 million people in Australia, which is roughly the size of LA County. So, like the problem is, in Australia, they have land. It was probably cheaper just to let them go out and pasture and roam and graze because that's what's available to them. So, I mean, yeah. We have 350 million here in the United States.
Yeah. So it's the only thing that makes sense. And so then when we get grass-fed beef here in the States, a lot of it ends up coming from Australia, New Zealand, Uruguay. These are places where there's a ton of grass-fed beef production. Another interesting lobbying piece is there was this thing a few years ago called COOL, Country of Origin Labeling. And basically what that did is they removed the requirement on beef or meat in general from having country of origin labeling. So a animal can be raised in Brazil and then shipped to the US. And then if they package it in the US, they can then put, it doesn't have to say product of Brazil, raised in Brazil, anything like that. It will say product of the USA because they packaged it here in the US. And so basically they've gone through and altered the requirements so that the foreign producers can, with their low prices of production, you know, because they don't have all the loopholes that we have here in the States, they can come in and undercut the pricing, which makes it even harder for the guys that are trying to do 100% grass-fed, regeneratively raised, et cetera, here in the States. Like they are facing an uphill battle pretty much every step of the way.
Can you get into some of the farming conventional practices that kill the ecosystems? You set us up with Taylor and Rome Ranch, and he kind of broke it down and explained everything and what was going on at the land that they got in Texas. And then he took us to the rejuvenated where all the buffalo were, and it was crazy. It was like not even the same land. He was like a football throw away. So what were the practices that killed the ecosystem to begin with?
Yeah, I mean, most things that exist in conventional agriculture, whether it be how we raise plants or animals, the way that conventional agriculture exists on the whole is destroying our ecosystem. And I'll get into some of those specifics, but like just to put a nail in how big this is, the UN came out with a report like 2 years ago, I want to say, that said at our current rate of soil loss and erosion, we have 60 harvests left. So 60 years of food production before we can't grow food anymore at all. Like, that's not just like a hypothetical 1,000 years from now, things are really going to be screwed. That's something that, like, if we live long enough, we're going to see the end of food production as it exists on this planet because of how we're treating our land and how we're just like kicking the can down the road in terms of the environmental outcomes. So that's fun.
You know, whenever I hear things like that, I'm like, well, I'm 40. I'm probably not going to make it to 100. God, my kids, you know, but yeah, you know, and kids. I think that's what everybody thinks, like, oh, you know what, this is going to be somebody else's deal to deal with. But, you know, I mean, it's like, whenever we talk about this stuff or whenever I'm kind of put with it, all I can think of is the ancient Greek proverb that, you know, a civilization grows great when old men plant trees they'll never sit in the shade of. So a civilization grows great when old men plant trees in shade that they'll never sit in. And that, like, I remember reading that and hearing that piece and just like, that was such an impactful statement for me. And when I hear this stuff, I think of the same thing. Like, if this is how we're gauging our society is not great. So it almost is, yeah, you know, put on us to set these things in motion so that, you know, these trees grow in the shade that we'll never sit in is for our children. And it seems like it just makes sense. I mean, when we went out to Rome Ranch, just like understanding like the symbiotic relationship between, you know, these ruminants being able to graze and tear up the land and then the birds, the ground nesting birds that follow them and break up everything and create all these ecosystems. And then, you know, the poop of the birds has nitrogen in it that goes in, mixes with the soil and it tears it all up. I mean, it just seems like as they explained it and from the research that we've done, it just makes sense. I just wonder if these large farms that are kind of stuck in this conventional, it's like they know that there's a better way, but they don't know how to kind of flip the switch and change it. And that's what you guys are there for. So I wonder, like, what it takes for a like huge ranch, like a huge production, huge beef cattle that's doing it conventional. Like, what does it take to come in and then switch? And how long does it take? And like, what is the process? Because to me, like, that's what I'm interested in. And like, how do we change it? And it's almost like if you can do it on like one massive scale and there's a model, then you can go out and present it to other farmers and be like, hey, like, you know, we got to plant trees and we're never going to sit in that shade, but we have to do something because if we don't, you know, and I know we can control our little ecosystem, but, you know, and then you kind of look at it like outside the United States. I mean, you know, I mean, we're talking about, you know, food production for 60 harvests in the United States. What about outside of that? So that's my question.
Yeah. And I guess on that, to add on, like, what are the costs associated for them as well? Like, why would they steer away? What are they losing? What incentives are they losing?
Yeah.
You know,
well, ahead. And I think all three questions that each of you guys just asked kind of, you know, are in that same vein of, you know, like, what does it look like to do things the right way? And what are they doing currently that is problematic? And so, you know, when you look at what the properly functioning ecosystem is of this planet, it's, you know, grasslands that, you know, have lots of grazing animals moving across them. What we've done is we have plowed up a lot of those grasslands and turned those into croplands. And so that's where a lot of our food production has come from. It's former grasslands that we've transitioned into cropland. So that's not the desirable state of that land. Alternatively, if you look at meat production or wool or leather, dairy, what have you, a lot of that is done in feedlots. And so it's taking these animals and putting them in an industrial setting where they're getting feed that's brought in from an outside place. They're getting pumped full of hormones. They've got these large manure pits that are coming out, and these manure pits have tremendous amounts of methane coming out of them, and that's a really bad greenhouse gas. So essentially, we've basically taken animals that used to be a tool for improving the environment, and we've put them in this industrialized model. And in doing so, it's wreaking havoc on the environment. And so that could be them in a feedlot. It could also be them just in a continuous grazing operation, like I was saying, where they're not moving around. And so that's still destroying the environment. So a lot of agriculture, whether it be cropland production, where you have these huge, huge landscapes of just one single species of corn, of soy, of strawberries, of almonds, whatever it is, you know, you've got just tons of a single species that exists. It's a monoculture. Monocultures don't exist in nature. Nature exists with polycultures. All these different symbiotic relationships of different plants and different animals working together with one another to have diversity on the landscape is what we want. So what we should be doing is having a farming food production system that respects the diversity of species that the land wants. And so we need to farm in nature's image and move away from the, you know, single species model. And that can look like a variety of different things. I mean, what we focus on at the Savory Institute is training farmers and ranchers how to graze. But there's other models of regenerative agriculture. Like if you've got a fruit orchard, you can, you know, be planning that in a way so that you are spreading compost on your ground, or maybe you have sheep coming in grazing between the rows of your orchard so that you're getting grasses to grow and, you know, you're creating that healthy environment down below on the canopy floor. If you're doing crops, there's people that are doing that where they're integrating livestock in with crop production. And so they're starting to bring back some of these symbiotic relationships. So it's not just that single species, let's get the most amount of production that we can on this piece of land so that we can make the most money. And who gives a damn what the environmental outcomes are from what we're doing? We're making a killing right now, and that's all that matters. That's what most of farming is at this time. And like, we're ultimately going to pay the price for it soon.
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun. So I guess,
so how,
John,
do we fix it?
Asking, like, what does that look like?
Yeah. Like, how do we fix it? Like, you know, as like, I think, at least the, you know, the one per or the few people on this podcast that aren't flat earthers are really looking at like, how do they like, what's the solution? Like, how do we fix this?
Yeah. So I think, you know, it's going to take a while to really unpack or dismantle the current agricultural system that we have here in the States, you know, or abroad. But there are some low-hanging fruits. So, you know, a rancher who's got livestock and, you know, they're in a continuous grazing operation, just getting them the training and the mindset of, hey, see your land. You see how your profits have been going down every year. You see how your land's getting worse and worse and worse as the years go on. Here's an alternative model that exists. It doesn't take a lot of, it's not anything that's resource intensive or machinery intensive to start doing things and moving them around in a regenerative way. You know, buying some portable electric fencing, setting up some watering points. It's not that expensive in the grand scheme of things compared to what ranchers or farmers are used to spending on the infrastructure and equipment and feed and hay and all this other stuff that they have going on at their ranch. And it's not, you know, manually more difficult to do. What's the most difficult part is really the intellectual side of things, of sitting down and planning and making the calculations, going out and looking at the grasses on your ranch and saying like, okay, what's the growth rate at this time of year? What parts of the ranch need more attention than others? And just coming up with a smart program and plan that meets the needs of your individual property. So it's really an intellectual mindset shift that we need in the farming and ranching communities for this to happen. It's not something that's, you know, extremely capital intensive or resource intensive to be able to do so. It's just changing the mindset that folks have because, you know, you come in and knock on someone's door and say, hey man, the way that you're grazing your animals is ruining the planet. You got to change this. That's basically saying that what he's been doing his entire life is wrong. And what his dad did his entire life was wrong. And what his granddad did his entire life was wrong. Like, and it goes back generations and generations. So there's this tradition behind all of this and ego that kind of gets in the way, preventing people from changing.
It sounds like the plot from Interstellar.
What?
So I remember, the movie.
Remember they're on a farm with nothing and they got to go search for a new planet because they ate everything and killed the soil?
All I remember is McConaughey. Then my buddy bought a Lincoln and now it's a big Lincoln commercial.
You haven't seen it?
No.
Wasn't there like dust falling and that was the patterns that he was supposed to read or something like that?
Yeah, it was it was really highbrow thinking, not very unconventional for the movies I like to watch. Fast and Furious 1-7-8.
Yeah, it's.
But I'm surprised you haven't seen it. It's pretty good. It's worth seeing.
Probably I'll check it out. I don't know, man. I'm like anything that's like Matt Damon is like a Martian and all that. Like I'm just kind of over that stuff.
It's Chris Nolan, so
I'm a little
the Batman guy.
Yeah, I'm good.
It's good.
Well, seeing as that the only person I know that has worse movie taste than Luke is you, I'm gonna.
That's impossible.
I'll take that as a compliment.
That is.
Thank you, John. Thank you.
Tex.
All right. Can we get back on subject?
Sure.
I'm very upset.
So, I guess.
Wait. Why are you upset that you're not very good at picking movies, or that you have terrible movie taste?
We've established in the history of the podcast that 1994 is the greatest movie year of all time.
2000 is runner up now. And a lot of ridiculous movies.
It is pretty good.
But getting back to it. Okay, so you have this. Understandably, like there's a heritage and identity to the practices of these guys, right? And that's something that's like the code you got to crack, which is seems like it's a heavy thing to do on your end. But what about like, is there anything just regular dudes who don't have a farm or aren't farming? Like, what do we do?
Yeah. Well, I think farmers pay attention to the markets. You know, they are listening ultimately to what the dollar tells them to do. And so they will follow where there is a market. And so I think if we give a shit about having a planet to live on, to have our kids inherit, then we should be voting with our dollars in favor of food that has, you know, contributed towards a better planet. You know, we should be supporting regenerative agriculture. You know, we vote 3 times a day with our dollar. And so, you know, finding a farmer, seeing what his practices are, and supporting him, I think, goes a long way. With the Savory Institute, we've found that that's a problem for a lot of consumers, is that people want to do the right thing, but they don't know how. You know, when you go to a store and you compare this steak to the other one, or this thing of yogurt to the other one, or this leather purse to that one, or this wool scarf to that one, like, how do you know how those animals were raised? Because you can have 100% grass-fed that is managed improperly, that still is degrading the landscape because it's coming out of a continuous grazing operation. Or you can have that 100% grass-fed beef that's been managed properly, that's contributing towards a better environment, and it's helping draw carbon out of the air and as like a climate change reversal solution and all these other things.
Anybody that are raising buffalo improperly? Or a buffalo kind of safeguarded against it, like just within their nature, it's very difficult to raise them in a conventional sense.
There are lots of bison that are fed in a feedlot. That is a common thing that I think a lot of people don't realize. They just assume that because bison are very wild, that you know they're out on pasture their entire lives. There's people that have bison out on too much land, so they're out there in those continuous grazing scenarios, you know, not given the land the adequate amount of time to recover. So yeah, there's definitely a lot of degraded bison ranches out there.
What's the size, like how much land per bison?
Oh, it totally depends on where you are and what your land does. I mean, you know, based on your soil type, based on the type of grasses that grow, you know, based on how much moisture you get, you know, precipitation you get throughout the year. You know, so for example, we've got a bison ranch here outside of Denver. We've got 7,500 acres and we raise 400 head of bison. And that's about the appropriate stocking rate currently. With how that land is producing grass, that's the appropriate stocking rate. we would like to influence the health of that land over time. You know, this is a property that was just given to our organization 2 years ago. So it's still new in the grand scheme of things. As our management influences the health of this land, we'd like to get more grass growing, in which case, you know, we'd like to see this ranch double in stocking rate as time goes on. Because if you're growing more grass, you can carry more animals on that same piece of land. So that's kind of our goal. And, you know, same, you know, to your question of, you know, what's the stocking rate, you know, per, you know, how much acreage per head, it totally depends on where you are and, you know, what's the management been like on that piece of land.
So I could probably get like one bison here at my land. You've been here. I probably could get maybe one, but I know
how much land do you have?
We got 16 acres.
16 acres. I think our stocking rate is probably, it's probably in that 15 to 20 rate. So yeah, you might be able to get one.
So I need to get my neighbor's land. If I can get Perkins' land in the back, then I could probably, he has 15 that he's trying to sell me. So if I had 30, I could probably get like two bison. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I would be stoked if I got to go out and look at those bison. I thought they were so neat. Like they're just
they're awesome. But they require much bigger fencing and greater infrastructure because they're so damn strong.
They just like walk so through stuff?
Oh my God. Yeah. They'll bust through fences. No problem. They can also jump really high. I think they can jump 6 feet. They can run up to 45 miles an hour.
I'm telling you.
And sustain that speed for quite a while. So we actually have ATVs out at our ranch, that go faster than most other ATVs. And we chose those so that we can outrun a bison if we have to.
Which ATVs are these? Which ones? Do you remember?
I could not tell you.
We're going to need makes and models of these fast ATVs.
Are we going to need to rebrand Field Strong with a bison head?
No, but I honestly think like, I don't know if we need to do that, but dude, I was always like been amazed. Like I remember years ago, I did a speaking engagement with Lauren Cordain in 2009. And he, as we were sitting there kind of going over like, you know, everything. And I was talking to him about my nutrition strategy and he pulled out all these pictures that he had had, of like the Plains Indians and like these early, you know, buffalo hunters and settlers. And I just remember the one picture was taken by obviously some buffalo hunters, but it would show two Plains Indians standing in front of this massive, buffalo. And like, I just remember their whole faces and their stomachs were all covered in blood and their guts were super distended. And there was a notation on the back that said, after the buffalo was shot, I guess they cut out the liver and like the organ meats, and they proceeded to eat like 6 to 10 pounds of organ meats fresh out of the animal. And you could see their guts were super distended and like the blood on their faces. And I just like seeing the sheer size. And then there was all the pictures of like the skulls and like all the carcasses for miles to see. But just seeing like the pictures of the herds, because I remember one of them had like it was obviously like a top vantage point, but the herd like, there was like thousands, like as far as the eye could see. And I always, you know, you go back to where the buffalo roam. Like, mm-hmm. I don't think that we had any idea of how many buffalo and just the sheer size. And then, obviously seeing pictures and I've seen them before, but like when we were at Rome Ranch, like being that up close to them, I'm like, these are the coolest animals I've ever seen. They look like, like hairy tanks on wheels and they're just super robust and just like just,
hooves on hooves.
Yeah, I mean, they're just badasses. And no, I dig them. I think, and then as I read up, like you said, man, they're fast. They can jump. Like they have a really insane sustained speed, like top speed. Like they can run for long periods of time.
And these are just the species of bison that exist right now. There used to be other species that have gone extinct. So there used to be even bigger bison that roamed the Great Plains that are long gone, but they've found the skeletal remains of that. And so they know that there used to be a lot more and a lot more different types than what we have right now. This is just the best we've got because it's all that's left.
Well, I'm and sure like we can do some genetic stuff and get it out. Like we saw Jurassic Park. That was real, right?
The bison version of Jurassic Park.
That I'd be up for.
You want to know something gnarly? So at our bison ranch out here outside of Denver, we've got evidence of the KT boundary. That's the geologic point that shows where the dinosaurs went extinct. So it's all that, you know, when the giant meteor hit in the Yucatan Peninsula, mm-hmm. 66 million years ago, and, you know, it was raining lava from the sky and it killed off 80% of life on the planet, including all the dinosaurs. Some of that ash and lava was fossilized through places like swamps. And so they hypothesized that there was a swamp that existed on our ranch 66 million years ago. And so we've got this little 1-inch layer on the hillside that if you cut away the hillside, we've got this layer of ash. And that's the point that the dinosaurs went extinct. And so there's iridium in the layer. Iridium is the extraterrestrial metal that comes from outer space. So that's how they know that it was a meteor that crashed into the Yucatan that killed off all the dinosaurs and everything. So we've got dinosaur bones. We've got KT boundary. We've got all this evidence of the fifth. It was the fifth great extinction on the history of planet Earth. And right now, climate change is poised to be the sixth great extinction if we don't do anything about it. So on our one ranch, we've got evidence of the fifth great extinction. And then through the grassland regeneration that we're doing, we're actively trying to prevent the sixth great extinction.
That's so cool.
Fucking boom.
No,
what are you doing with your land, Welbourn?
Well, I got horses.
Watching horses.
Horses shoot shit everywhere.
Canter? Is it canter? Gallop?
I'm not kidding you, man. Like, I want to try to get more land so we can get a bison. Like, I know we don't have enough for them yet, but like, that's my goal, is to try to get enough land to where we could actually have a bison. How cool would it be to look out there and be like, holy shit, it's watching me. What if it runs through the wall? And then we could make Texas go out there and change direction.
Yeah, I like that type of danger. Like,
I think they're cool.
Walk into the office. Am I going to get hit by the bison today?
Are you going to sprint in?
I'll be fine.
I'll just say it might be easier to raise cows or sheep or goats or something like that. All these different grazing animals all do the same thing to the land in the grand scheme.
Yeah, but that's not really the power athlete way. We're going to look for like the most extreme version and being like, can we get horns on that thing? Maybe like a machine gun.
Let's go for this.
Yeah. Neighbor.
Why don't you get a longhorn?
They're totally useless. Yeah. They just stand around all day. They call them yard art. My neighbor has a gang of goats, and it's pretty funny because...
there's a couple new babies.
Yeah, he's got a bunch of new babies. The sad part is like I kind of like, you know, been driving by, so I do like a kind of a mental count of how many goats. He loses probably 2 to 3 goats a month to predators and different stuff. So I'll be like, oh, what happened to that guy? Big goat's dead, and predators get it, and like... It's just part of the natural process. And like he used to have like 5 dogs and now he's down to 1 dog because the goats will get out on the road and the dogs will try to go get the goat back and they get hit by cars because people drive too fast.
So is the coyotes getting them?
Yeah, it's the coyotes. The babies either get picked up by the coyotes or the foxes, or like the babies get taken down by a bunch of stuff. But yeah, it's the coyotes. And
have you read that book, Coyote America?
Mm-mm.
Oh man, that is a fascinating book. They talk about coyotes and how adaptable they are as a species, and just how fucking smart they are in the grand scheme of things. But you know how you hear the coyote calls at the end of the night? What they're doing is they're doing a roll call of everyone that exists. And the alpha female is paying attention to the saturation point that exists in the area that they're in. And so she gets a sense that they don't have enough, that they can stand to have more coyotes, like maybe some folks are missing. She'll throw off a larger litter. So if she was going to have a litter of 2, she could throw off a litter as high as, I think he said 19 in the book. Like, it's insane. So when people go, you know, a lot of folks, you know, throughout history, they've tried to kill off the coyote populations through like strychnine poisoning or just going out and shooting them or whatever it may be. What they're doing is just increasing the population with every coyote you kill, because you kill one coyote and then that alpha female is going to throw off like a dozen more. So
you got to get to find the alpha female.
It's like,
well, there's just going to be another alpha female that comes and takes place.
Then we get her.
We've had a decent amount of coyotes. I mean, I usually shoot them on site. The old guy I remember I talked to told me you got to stake them up. So if you know, like, cause I guess when they do roll call, if one doesn't answer, they come looking. And so if you can stake them up, they'll come and they'll find them. And then, allegedly they go away, but it hasn't worked.
I heard the calls cause I was here the other night and man, it was some of the coolest things. I just sat outside and listened. It was awesome.
Yeah. No, if I catch them on the cams, I'll go out there and, you know, I mean,
I was on a hike with old Harry Shaw at Mount Austin with the dogs off the leash and shit. It was 6:45 last Wednesday, I think. And it's like a pretty decent hill, good amount of switchbacks, and we're going.
A.M.
Yeah, A.M. And one of my dogs is just a moron and just a fucking ball of energy, so I just let her go. Just let her go. And she's ahead probably 25 yards. And I kind of see a deer up in... you know, maybe 40 yards out, and I'm like, oh, she'll probably chase him, right? So she goes out, bolts at that fucking deer. Deer kind of kicks back behind us, going the other way down like a service road. And I see her whiz by, and then right on her fucking tail is coyote. And I'm like, fuck, well, that dead dog, right?
Yeah, no, they eat dogs.
So I have like another little dog who's blind and equally as useless. And so he's kind of close, has no fucking clue what's going on. But my instinct is I just started running after the dogs, and I just barked at them, hey, as loud as I fucking could. And that fucking coyote stopped and looked at me, and I just fucking like postured up and sprinted off the trail right at that fucking coyote. And then he kind of looped around off the trail, and I just kind of tried to like take a pursuit angle on him, and he fucking kept going. And my buddy Harry he's like, oh, did you see that deer? I'm like, bro, you didn't see that fucking coyote?
He's like, no.
He's like, no, sabe, que paso? And so Harry's a Mexican friend of mine. So then I'm like, dude, there's a fucking coyote. And I'm wearing my heart rate monitor and my fucking like 189 beats per minute. And I'm like, fuck, man, like pretty hyped up. And like dogs have no fucking clues. So we keep going up, and he's like, there's no fucking coyote. What are you talking about? And as we get up to like this next service road kind of step off, the coyotes are down the fucking road, just on the road watching us.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, we're fucking coyote bait right now. Like if I let these dogs go, they're probably going to get picked up.
Yeah, they
like
raptors, dude.
I know they kill domestic dogs, and they obviously.
Oh, my dogs would be fucked.
Well, they and they breed with domestic females a bunch.
Oh no shit.
Yeah, and I know the wolves do that. But
like, I could picture fucking Louie and Vinny like, hey, sweet friends. Maybe get shredded, maybe shred them.
Lou, my one dog, is not that dumb to get far enough. Yeah, my other dog, Vinny, is an idiot. He would get eaten in like seconds.
I don't know. I think he'd fight his way out.
I think he'd think they're playing.
No,
but it was a great time.
Well, the funny thing about pit bulls is they're pretty sweet, and I think I told you this like years ago.
Bottle down. It's a bottle of vodka.
Sorry. Years ago, I remember I had my pit bull Bear, and we went to a dog park. And he was like super nice dog, like the sweetest dog you'd ever been around. And this other dog kind of bowed up on him, and he was kind of a little nervous. And I saw him get like a little submissive, and the dog fucking went at him. And 10,000 years of evolution, and also the pit bull fucking thing, he snapped. And like turned into a fucking pit fighter. He got down. He snatched the dog by its neck. Fucking ripped it up. Like literally, I was like, "Oh my god!" And the woman's screaming. And I was like, "Your fucking dog bit my dog." And the dog fucking—I mean, that's like evolution comes out. And he fucking tore this thing up. And I'd never seen it again. But he'd never been in that position again. So I always think with like dogs, like, you know, oh, they never do anything, and then all of a sudden they're in that position.
Oh, yeah,
and like evolution takes over. I hope. And, you know, I wish we could say the same thing for humans.
Here's where that, like, the whole vegan narrative of, like, we just need to treat all the animals with respect and everything's going to be kumbaya.
Stomp the vegans for a little bit. I feel like kicking them in the balls repeatedly. So anything good you want to say? Yeah, I mean, it doesn't make any fucking sense. Like, oh,
nature.
You know. Oh, being like, the reason that they're eating meat is because we're forcing them to eat meat. I heard that one the other day, and I'm like, so the lion is being forced to eat? Get the fuck out of here.
I find that vegans, I can have a good conversation with a vegan on the environmental side of things. And I've brought many a vegan back to our side through the environmental discussions of, hey, not all meat is raised the same way. You know, there are those that are destroying the planet, but like, let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater and ruin it for those of us that are trying to regenerate this land. So like, let's find a commonality. And that works in some areas, but then you do have those that are just, you know, far off the deep end that are like, you can never touch an animal. You have to let them do everything. That it's the arguments that they put forward just don't.
It kind of reminds me of like the pro-life people killing the doctors. Like that one, like I don't remember, there was like pro-life person and they ended up like killing like the doctor at the abortion clinic. And I remember I'm like, so you're protecting life by killing life. Like that one just didn't make sense to me. I don't know, dude, the vegan stuff, it just does like the narrative has never made sense to me. And we know like, I mean, and I got into a big battle with some people recently where I was like, you know, probably the least blood soaked diet is one of pasture raised meat, you know, chickens mm-hmm. and eggs, and went through it like the one that we eat. The amount of death and mayhem that comes from like the production and of traditional farming for your vegan diet, it's a much more blood soaked diet. I mean, like, you know, everything from squirrels to deer to ground nesting birds. I mean, all of those things are actually killed within the production of that. And there was a gal who was on there who was like, yeah, I grew up working on a bean farm. And she's like, my job was to pick the dead animal carcasses out as when they dumped all the beans. We were like, there were like dozens of people and our job was to pick out the dead carcasses so they could process everything. She's like, each harvest killed like thousands of animals because that's their food source. So it's like, and I got into it with these people about it. And the eventual argument that came out was that, cows and large ruminants are, is it, what's it, sentient. Yeah, sentient beings and deserve a higher level of respect than these smaller mammals like deer and like and rodents and all these
and
others.
Like even insects, if you want to.
Yeah, and insects, like those don't have as much value in life. So those are acceptable casualties in this, in the war against. And like when they said that, I'm like, you guys are fucking insane. Like there's
basically what they're saying is because these species are larger and cuter and I can relate to them more because I can see more of myself in them. I value their life more than something that is different from me. And I mean, that I think sounds familiar in terms of like racism and sexism and everything else. So I think this should be speciesism in some way.
Well,
I, they're saying that this life is less important because it doesn't look like me. And well, I think that's bullshit.
I got into it with somebody recently too about hunting, and they asked me like, in Texas, do we hunt? I'm like, you have to hunt. The deer populate so fast that if you don't take a certain amount of deer and like keep the population down, they sprint into traffic and they hit cars and people die. Mm-hmm. And they were like, well, that's acceptable. We're using in their habitat, shouldn't you know? And I'm like, okay, so you're in California, you've never hunted, you have no concept, you've never been to Texas. I'm like, do you have any idea, not only the life of the deer hitting the car, what happens to them and the person they hit? So they're going to die anyway, and the person in the car is going to die. Or we can go out and reduce the population and take our fair share of deer, which prevents this. And so you're okay with those deer dying in the most violent fucking manner ever and the person in the car dying too? Yes. And I was like, this is fucking crazy. Like I don't even understand the reasoning. Like I always think, you know, like when you sit down to have a discussion or an argument or you're on two opposing sides, I believe that there has to be like a concession of rationality. And what we found here, and like especially with a lot of people in the vegan deal, I mean, we run into it in fitness all the time, is where people have completely, I guess, abandoned any rational thought because the rational thought doesn't confirm their bias.
Mm. Yeah. It's a fucked up world that we live in. And I feel like whether we're coming from the fitness side of things, the nutrition side of things, the agricultural side of things, there are these different camps that exist and people have their viewpoints that they're going to defend till the death. And they aren't open to new ideas or reconsidering their preconceived notions and what brought them there. And they just want to have a belief. And, you know, we are very tribal as a species. And so they want to exist in their tribe and they will defend it till the death, which is really unfortunate, you know, because there's a lot of people that I think, you know, you want to give people the best opportunity. You know, you want to give a farmer the opportunity to realize that, hey, there's a different way of doing things. You want to give a vegan an opportunity to realize like, oh man, maybe I am experiencing some massive nutrient deficiencies and I should probably reincorporate some animal products into my diet. Or, hey, maybe running all these ultra marathons is not the best of ideas. That's my personal story. I used to be a big Tex. I remember back at CrossFit DuPont back in like 2009, you had us write down our goals, like that we wanted, like our fitness goals and like what we wanted to work on. And mine was like, I just want to be the best ultra marathon runner I can be. And I just remember you just had this really disappointed look on your face.
Yeah, I kicked you out of the gym. I fired you. No, not really. But eventually got you on Field Strong, right? And you stopped running and started eating meat.
Oh, so you were a vegan.
No, God, no. I was eating meat.
So you were a vegan marathon, ultra marathon runner. I survived on soy protein shakes.
I can confirm.
And my nipples
that.
Hurt.
I believe you were somebody started this thing called a meet up, M-E-A-T, within that DuPont community, the balance community.
Yeah, it was the DC paleo community back in 08, 09.
Early,
you know, like when Rob Wolf's book had like just come out and paleo was still this like lunatic fringe thing.
Oh, yeah. And I was, you I was know, the guy bringing a sixer to this and like nobody else was drinking beers. And I'm like, man, maybe I...
You know what? Rob's book and the original kind of information for the paleo diet always makes a ton of sense to me. And even to this day, we probably eat within 90% of that deal. Mm-hmm. I mean, other than like, you know, I'd say some rice cakes as a snack, but like...
What?
I know.
Snack guy.
I had some delicious Triscuit crackers in the car.
Right? I would have had more rice cakes or somebody killed all my rice cakes. I was like, who ate all these fucking rice cakes?
Wait, you had rice cakes too?
It was the coyotes.
So you had rice cakes? You had
rice cakes?
Tex stayed at my house this week while we were out in California visiting my mom. And I came back and I was like, the girls are like, who ate all of our snack food? Because it's all these like little kid snacks. I'm like, yeah, who ate all the rice cakes? I'm like, it's probably that bear that was in there. To go back, like I remember like talking to Rob, and this is in 2009 when I first met him, about the paleo diet and being like, yeah, you know, eat some meat, you know, eat some carbs. Like it became like it was very simple. And then over the course of like the next like 4, 5, 6, 7 years, like I don't know where people fucking lost their minds.
Well, the paleo rule book, right?
Well, is no, but no, dude, it just like...
They found out they could make money by making products and slapping the paleo logo on
But people name. Like, believe me, I'm totally fine with like paleo treats and if people like whatever, like go for it. But like the idea, like where people got like so militant in like, this is paleo, this isn't. And it became this almost like weird cultish religion.
Well, caveman can't boil potatoes. So it's not technically paleo.
Well, I remember us being like, well, can you know, did the potato not exist? I'm like, Jesus Christ, like this is crazy. And I remember trying to like answer
the
these
origin of don't be weird.
This is where the exact origin of don't be weird. So I have a whenever I give a nutrition talk, there's always the final piece is the number one rule, which I kind of work backwards. I'm like, the final level and the number one rule with nutrition is don't be weird. If you find yourself like joining a buffalo loincloth and going out there and doing this whole thing because you think caveman did it and like just like take a step back, come back to reality and don't be weird. And like I felt like the whole paleo thing jumped the shark when like everybody was just so fucking far out there to the point where I always loved Rob's original work and we always kind of ate that way and to the point where like I was like, man, we're not going to talk about this in terms of this. And I would use like, I don't know, I eat like a meat diet. We eat some primal stuff. Like I tried to avoid the word paleo just because the weirdo stigmatism of it, like it just like, and even Rob's confused. Rob's like, yeah, it was a great idea. And then people just fucking took it to like the nth degree and kind of fucked it all up, which is what they're kind of doing with the keto diet right now too.
Oh yeah.
It's happening everywhere. I mean, shit, it's happening, you know, in our space, in regenerative agriculture. Everyone's, you know, dying to put a label on regenerative and say, no. What I do and the way I say you should be doing things is regenerative. Like everyone just wants their piece of the pie. And so what we're doing actually in the ag space is, you know, you look at the word regenerative and what does that mean? Like it means that the land is getting better over time. So rather than trying to list out a set of practices of what you can and can't do and having a checklist, we're just going out and measuring the health of the land. And if it gets better over time, then you can carry a seal on your product that says ecological outcomes have been verified. So that's how we're trying to like break through the noise in the ag space, because we see this tribalism, this desire to slap a label on something. And, you know, when you do that and you create these specific boundaries, people bastardize it and turn it into something that totally flies in the face of what it originally was intended to do. You know, paleo was originally intended to just get people to stop eating crap and eat real food that's appropriate for your diet and your activity level. Like, great, not that difficult. And then it becomes all these uber processed, bulletproof, upgraded everything shit that exists and is probably worse for people than what they were eating beforehand.
Well, isn't everybody like looking for this? The other problem is if one's good, 100's better. So everybody gets into this hack thing and then it becomes like a paleo with the I just remember being like, dude, like you should. And I think we probably lost steam on this by trying not to be in crazy, because I've realized true success happens when you're extremely polarizing. So the problem is that the majority of people, for them
I'd call that the easy success. Well, it's easy to be polarizing.
It is, but
above spit and shine and sell the fucking.
But like, if you look at social media and the majority of stuff, like it comes through, and actually like the middle of the road, non-crazy person approach is by far the least polarizing and sexiest one. Like if you can be like, if you only don't eat for 23 hours, you can eat 10,000 calories in an hour. You'll be shredded. Oh yeah, that totally works. And people get stuck into this thing. And like,
is that a real thing?
Yeah, I want to start. But like,
that's a lot of chips and salsa.
But then we get into this, and I like, dude, when I got up and gave like nutrition talks, and Tex was at one of the first ones, it was pretty basic. Like, you know,
lots of cheese.
I don't remember that.
I got to find that
spreadsheet. Please do. Every meal should be based around some form of animal based protein. I mean, the only ones that are valuable are the ones with, you know, faces and souls and a mother. And then
regeneratively raised.
Regeneratively raised. Yeah. Yeah, I mean,
I guess 100%.
We'll have to qualify. Yeah, we'll have to qualify. And then you should add in fat and carbohydrate based off of training, energy expenditure, palate, and more importantly, like what your physiological or what you're trying to do in terms of lean, bulk, and all those other things just come out without with playing with macros and doing that. And it's just like, I don't know where everything. Oh, I do know where it is. They brought in a bunch of marketers that realized the sexier and the more difficult we can make this, and the more magic we can give it the appearance, the easier it is to sell. Because if it was so easy or if it was so simple, then nobody would need this stuff and everybody would already be in good shape and healthy. And it's just become this, like, man, when people ask me about the nutrition space, I'm like, I really like the you know, this, what did you say? Ethically raised? Not ethically.
Regeneratively
raised. Is there a list, like a layman like us? I mean, I know we work with Stay Classy and some and try to you know, specifically work with farms that are in this space. But I wonder, like on the Savor Institute, do you guys have a list of people you work with or recommended people?
So that's really what we're getting at. When I mentioned that ecological outcome verification seal, EOV, that's a program that we've been building for the last few years with researchers from Michigan State University and Texas A&M and others, basically to make sure that it's scientifically robust and it's valid and, you know, you can't poke holes in it. So now what we're doing is we're going out and we're setting up that data collection at farms and ranches all around the world, because we don't work just here in the US. I mean, we work with, you know, cowboys in the West and the Maasai in Kenya and gauchos in Patagonia and sheep herders in Norway. Like, there's people managing livestock all across the globe. So we're helping them be better stewards of the land. And now with the ecological outcome verification, we're measuring the health of their land so that their products, when they come to market, can carry that seal so that you know. So like, you've been talking about Rome Ranch a lot, you know, if for those listening that don't know, Rome Ranch is owned by Katie and Taylor, who are the founders of Epic Bar. So Epic Bar is a big supporter of regenerative agriculture. They've been working with the Savor Institute for years to improve their supply chains and where they source from, which we commend them from, and they're awesome. But they realized that it's difficult to do this, and not everyone has that direct line to the Savor Institute to find the best sourcing. So they really pushed us to develop a program that would help improve supply chains so that we can get more of these farmers and ranchers that we've trained all around the world. I mean, we've trained, you know, probably like 8,000 farmers and ranchers. We've regenerated 25 million plus acres, you know, in like the past decade or so. And so we're trying to get that product differentiated so that when you go to the store, you can see that EOV logo and know that that came from regenerating land, and then there's data to back it up. And it's not just soil carbon. It's looking at water holding capacity, the amount of bare ground, the different species of plants, making sure there's a diversity, like looking at a whole composite score of land health and see that that trends in the positive direction. So to your question of, is there a list? Not yet, but there are a few products that are out that have the EOV seal. So Epic has their beef sriracha bites have the EOV seal on it whenever you see that. They've also got two new products that are coming out. I actually don't think they have been announced yet, but I asked them and they said I could mention it here on the podcast. Boom. So, boom.
I love dropping new information. Bring it.
Yeah. So the world premiere of the new EOV products from Epic. No, they're beef liver bites are a new product that are coming out. So you can get that liver, get the organ meat, all the nutrition.
Yeah, we're in it.
Yep.
That's part of the Power Athlete staple, organ meats.
Hell yeah. Yep. So the beef liver bites are going to be carrying the EOV seal on it. And then also their pastured pork lard. So, you know, like the lard that you cook with.
Oh, and the stuff that Tex showers in. Is that the stuff he wipes all over his body?
I think so.
Yeah.
It's called, no, that's just my belly. It's called hard lard.
Ah.
Hey,
I thought that's what, you know, you guys grease yourself up on the weekends and go out and wrestle.
I thought hard lard was when you mixed vodka and like beef fat.
No, it's mayonnaise and vodka. We call that hard lard.
That's the hard lard.
Yeah.
Hard lard?
Yeah.
Jesus.
It's a delicious cocktail.
Oh, you imagine going to a bar and be like, what do you have? Do you have any mayonnaise back there? I need some
take
mayonnaise.
Take a Budweiser and two hard lards.
Oh, what's you that? Better believe I'm going to try to order this.
Mayonnaise.
Proof and Coop, first of all, hard lard?
I fucking hate mayonnaise.
Okay, how about like...
I'm not a mayonnaise
not
fan.
Not enough vodka.
Well, what about like...
Did you guys ever see the one with Undercover Brother when they were trying to like train him to be a white dude? Who was the guy with...
what's his fucking name?
Tommy...
Eric Griffin?
Yeah, Tommy Griffin?
No, something Griffin.
Yeah.
Eddie Griffin?
Eddie Griffin. Yeah, when they were trying to teach him to be a white dude, and they were like, you're going to be presented with mayonnaise, and we got like a little ring to shoot some hot sauce to make it palatable. Our brother can't handle mayonnaise. I fucking died. Like, that was the funniest shit, because I don't like mayonnaise. I'm like, but I'll take hot sauce. So I don't know if that's a black person, white person thing.
No, I don't like mayonnaise either.
I don't like mayo.
I'll eat it. I'm fine with it now, but I'm out.
I can't remember telling you the last time I had mayonnaise.
Let's get back to hard lard. What about tequila and bacon grease? Like, that's legitimately hard lard.
Well, this is my whole brand of cocktails.
Oh, so it's
it's just taking some form of fat and then adding some alcohol and then boom.
But it has to be animal fat.
Oh, yeah. Well, responsibly, it's got to be EOV, pasture raised, approved
animal fats.
Lard.
So did Tex come up with all this stuff at Balance at the, you know, the CrossFit in DC?
I never drank a hard lard. So no, this is all new information to me. Although there is a brewery here in Denver. It's a heavy metal brewery, which I think is awesome because you go and you can just listen to some great metal and drink some great beer. Oh. And they've got a shot that they call a hot beef injection, which is a shot of Jameson followed by a beef au jus chaser. And it is fucking delicious.
I'll do that.
Probably the worst drink I've ever had was something called Dracula's Blood, which was 151 in Tabasco.
Yeah, like Prairie Fire, right? Similar, but 151?
Yeah, what was Prairie Fire? Tequila in Tabasco.
Yeah, I think so.
But the Dracula's Blood was 151 in Tabasco. Mm-hmm.
Oh, God.
Have you ever had Malort's?
Well, I'll tell you my story about Malort's. Malort's is wormwood. Right. So wormwood is what they make absinthe from, the green fairy, the whole deal, and Van Gogh cutting his ear off. And when we were in Amsterdam, we went to this bar that actually had like the original absinthe. And there's like a whole deal where you like you take it and then you put like there's like a sugar on a spoon and you light it on fire and you go and you drink this stuff. Gasoline, and I've had to huff gasoline. I mean, dude,
actually drank gasoline. Well, and this tasted worse.
I'll tell you this: have you ever siphoned gasoline? Like, like we ran out of gas, we had to siphon gas, and as you're sucking on the on the pipe or on the
hose
on the hose to get the deal, all of a sudden, once the suction starts, the way that you know is because you get a mouthful of fucking gasoline, and then you put it in the thing, and that's how you siphon gas. I did that. We siphoned gas, and I had a mouthful of fucking gasoline. The absinthe tasted worse than the fucking gasoline.
Mm.
And then we did
try hard lard,
and then we proceeded to drink more of it, and it was fucking awful. The absinthe. Yeah. I didn't cut my ear off, thank God, but I know why Van Gogh cut his ear off.
I tried it once, and nothing happened. I forget where a buddy had it, but it could have been some knockoff bullshit or fucking like vodka with green Jolly Rancher in it. Who the fuck knows?
No, it was, you got to drink that stuff in some weird bar in Amsterdam that smells like cheese and other weird stuff.
How do we get to this topic?
So you guys were asking about how you can find regenerative products.
Next thing you know, we're talking about absinthe in Amsterdam. That's what we like to do.
about hard lard. No, so I mentioned, just to like finish off the list of, you know, like places that you can find. So Epic has one product and a couple more coming out that are going to have EOV on it. There's some of our folks in the Savory Network. They've come out with a new brand, actually, that just launched at Paleo FX. It's like beef sticks and a nut butter that goes on top of it, which sounds like a really weird combination. But when you try it, trust me, that shit is crack. It is so good. It is delicious. People are going nuts over it. But that's all EOV verified. So it's, you know, coming from farms and ranches that they manage themselves as savory hubs. And that's called Rep Provisions, eatrep.com. That's coming out soon. It's delicious. It's so good. We are working with brands like Applegate. You know, you see them, you know, at lots of different stores. They're working on coming out with some EOV products. So, you know, probably look towards 2020 with that. They're a much bigger company, so their supply chains are really complicated. So it takes time to work with them on this sort of stuff to improve that. But, you know, I give it to them that they're making the commitment to put their money where their mouth is. There's like Zook's Natural Pet Foods. That's like a pet food company that's, you know, committed to better sourcing. We're working with Caring Group. They're the holding company for like Gucci and Stella McCartney and Puma and Volcom and all these other lifestyle and luxury brands. So they're trying to get better wool and leather in their supply chain. So this isn't just a food thing. This is also fiber. And then there's like smaller regional brands that you can find that our different savory hubs are working with. So, you know, could be like a local beef brand that you see at the farmer's market or in your little co-op store and whatnot. So we're working with the big multinational brands, but then we're also working with the small guys because, you know, regenerative takes a lot of different forms. It could be, you know, a small little 5-acre farm with a few animals, or it could be a big 20,000 acre ranch with like huge herds of grazing animals. It comes in all different contexts. So, you know, look for the EOV seal to know that it is definitely from a regenerative land base that has metrics to justify it. Or if you want to just find your local savory hub, these are basically the learning centers that farmers and ranchers go to learn these methods and these practices. We've got 43 of them around the world. And so they're all over the place. If you go to our website, savory.global, we've got a map that you can search and see, you know, find your local savory hub and just get in touch with them. And I'm sure they'll be able to plug you in with a local farmer who's got some supply for you.
Legit. Awesome.
Killer, dude.
You got anything else?
Yeah, man. Here we are 10 years later. What's your training goal? What are you training for, man?
That is a good question. Well, I am no longer running, so I have quit that.
Thank God you saw the light.
I did. Oh, I mean, I enjoyed it. It was fun to put myself through that challenge. And like, I got second place at a 100-mile race once. The only race I ever won was a beer mile. So
that counts in my book. Those are the real races.
I used to train with these dudes at CrossFit Newport. Brian McKenzie and those dudes used to run those ultras and all those far races. Mm-hmm. And like, I just remember them being like, "Oh, I'm doing a little 50 miler this weekend." And I just remember thinking, yeah, like, if you told me, and like this was my perception, like, "Hey, we got to like jump in the car. We got to go somewhere." And it's like 50 miles. I'd be like, "Do we got like water? Do you have snacks? Like, where are we going? Do we have directions?" like 50, 100 miles is like, that's a couple hour drive.
It will fuck you up. That's basically what clued me in that I needed to stop running. So after the Old Dominion 100 miler, I got second place, 19 hours and 11 minutes. I had some IT band syndrome issues that took about 6 months to get better. And then when I finally got better, I was like, "Cool, I can start running again." And I signed up and I did the Hellgate 100K, which is this, it's 66.6 miles. It starts at midnight, you know, in December. You got to cross a stream within the first 2 miles. So it's just designed to be brutal. And actually, David Goggins actually was racing. I know a lot of people are big Goggins fans these days. I'm proud to say I beat David Goggins in that race.
Well, he's not real fast.
He is. He's a great runner.
I'm just kidding.
He just had a bad day. He was suffering. That's the only reason I beat him.
Did you talk shit to him as you went by?
No. Oh. No. I may have smacked his ass when I ran by. I'm not quite sure. But after that race, I had some pretty bad knee pain and I went and got an MRI, and it turns out that I had a stress fracture on my femur. And so I was like, all right, I've been out for 6 months with IT band. Now I got a stress fracture on my femur. Like, this shit just is not working. Like, I'm a
too much soy. Too much soy. That soy-based vegan diet you're eating obviously didn't pay dividends.
Yeah, the bitch tits should have clued me in. That
a lot of anterior weight when you have those man boobs, you know?
You got to talk to Tex about this. Every day, Starbucks soy latte.
Four plums, vanilla. Yeah.
What? Yeah.
Hold the decaf.
Decaf soy latte.
Oat
every day.
Milk. Yeah. Oat milk, actually.
Why do you drink soy? Why is it?
It makes his nipples hurt. Actually,
I'm into that.
And he lactates every day when we get upset at him.
He's got to save the cows for the hard lard. You know, the evening mama's medicine. And there goes our last listener. Okay, better cancel future episodes. No.
No.
Okay, so you got all fucked up, and then how long did it take for you to get out of this rut?
I don't know. It was like another 4 months before that stress fracture on the femur was better. So I basically quit running after that. I was like, you know, my body's trying to tell me something. So that's when I got serious about lifting and, you know, started to follow Field Strong and whatnot. So as for what I'm training for right now, honestly, like, my work schedule is all over the fucking place. Like, I'm going to be in Kenya for 2 weeks this July, and like, I'm going all over the place. So my main training goal is just have some level of consistency and not lose what I got. I've been working towards a 400-pound squat for a while, and I finally got that not too long ago while wearing my Eat the Week shirt. Huh? So, you know.
Guaranteed at least another 10%.
That's correct.
Absolutely, 100%. So yeah, just trying to maintain what I got there and just not lose it with like insane work travel.
We got to get you on Grindstone.
Yeah, he's a Grindstone guy now.
We probably do. We probably do.
So when you go to Kenya and you see the Maasai warrior, like, I'd like to see, I'm always fascinated by the fact that they can jump like 7 feet in the air with straight legs. Like, it's all like ankle dorsiflexion plant. Like, it's crazy to watch those guys jump. And they're also super tall. They're always like, you know, like 6'5", 6'7". They're all super tall dudes.
Yeah, freaks.
Yeah, weirdos are that tall. I was looking at you and I was like 5'6".
You were looking at me like, yeah, they're also tall, like 5'8".
Like 5'6" and a half, like real tall.
when I'm out there with the Maasai in July, I will ask them the secrets of their ways and see if I can bring that back so that it can form some programming.
We could use a little bit of picture.
Everyone in the power athlete world jumping like Maasai warriors.
It'd be cool if we could get a picture when they do their little, they do their hops. If we could get you in there with them, trying to do a picture.
We do Maasai jumps in Field Strong.
We do. Yeah, we do. That's what we call them.
Yeah. I'll be damned.
I had a guy the other day tell me he couldn't figure out the cocky walks. And when I hit him back, he only follows the program from the emails. He doesn't click through and see the demo. And I was like,
well, didn't see the whole point there, pal.
Yeah, that's what I said. I don't have time to log into the app. I'm just following. I'm like, well, that's going to be a problem.
Oh, logged in. Like, that's it.
Or the Power Athlete YouTube channel also has cocky walks and movement demos available. If you find yourself reading off the email.
That's a good one.
So how would you get to YouTube?
Through the same thing you're looking at your email from.
You don't know
anything. The computer?
The files
are in the computer.
Tex, have you taken our information systems training yet?
Yes.
And you passed?
I have not.
I'm not worried about you over there. I'm worried about CD-ROM over here, you know?
Oh, you need me to burn you something?
Oh, the files are inside the computer.
What else we got, Tex?
Well, we talked about his training history. We need to figure out where...
When are you back down in Texas? Doesn't Savior Institute have a farm out here?
I was here for Paleo FX. That was back in April. I'm not sure when I'm going to be out in Texas. I mean, if you give me a reason to come on out, I will.
Ooh, we can maybe do that.
We're going to need two buffalo. We're going to need two buffalo.
Or we carry on.
I just want some animals that'll defend themselves. Because, dude, like I said, dude, my neighbor gets his goats killed all the time. I'm like, I don't know. Like, I've got kids. And they're always like, oh, look, there's baby goats. And they want to go name them. And I'm like, God, do you imagine if, like, Like I had to deal with the crisis of the bird getting eaten by the snake today, and I can't even imagine if like we're missing half of our goats and kids.
Isn't
are like,
there a Simpsons episode like this with a sheep or something?
Gotta be.
Yeah, Simpsons did it.
It's just like the kids, like it's just like having these conversations, like they're all like standing around crying because this snake ate. I'm like, it's nature. It's Texas. It's weird shit. And then I try to give him like, this is a metaphor for life, that no matter how far up and how much you protect your nest, snakes are always going to get in and eat your babies. So don't go out of the house. Exactly. And then my wife's like, no, no.
Wrong metaphor.
Yeah. I was like, no, that one didn't make any sense.
Too much. But well, Bobby, if you're out in Austin, man, and I guess number one, we got symposium coming up in December. That's a few months off. But if something comes up in the interim, we'll definitely reach out to you.
You know, I would love to get on back there because last time I passed on through, I think I was only at HQ for like 45 minutes or so. So we'll love to pop in, get a workout, you know, see some of them animals that you got going on. And then maybe we can all go out to Rome Ranch again, because I don't see you getting bison out there anytime soon, John. So
I know.
We'll just, use Rome as your local bison
ranch. Are you suggesting we steal one like in The Hangover?
One, we need two precision drivers.
I was thinking my goal is to try to...
How hard could it be to steal a bison? Let's be honest.
No, I have a... You guys know I'm always scheming like master plans. I'm like, how much land do I need? What I need is the savory people to sign off on it. You have enough land for two bison. And then what will happen is you guys will come to work and be like, are those bison out there? I'll be like, yeah, we got them. Bobby signed off on it. Was he out here? Yeah, no, we brought him out here. I didn't tell you guys, but we got bison now. And that's... Okay.
I'm just going to say now I did not sign off on that.
For the record. Let the record show.
Let the record show. Savory did not approve of that.
I don't really like cows. I think that I just don't like them. I like buffalo better. I think in a battle, like one bison would kill like 20 cows.
I think that's fair.
And then we eat them. Yeah, I don't see a problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We could do that.
Yeah.
Well, Bobby, hey, man, I guess... Where should people go? So we have savory.global. Is there like a social presence that folks should follow for you?
Yep. You can find us on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. Our handle on most of those is at Savory Institute. So follow along. There's some cool stuff, you know, looking at infographics. Actually, thinking about infographics, there was one thing that I think people would be interested to see. So, you know, that farm I was mentioning earlier with all the bald eagles?
Yes.
Down in Georgia. They did a life cycle analysis recently on all the different greenhouse gas emissions that happen on their farm. So, you know, what comes from the manure emissions, what comes from the belching of the cattle, what comes from the processing and like the trucking and moving things around, all those different things. And then looking at the carbon sequestration, you know, what happens, you know, the carbon that's drawn into the soil. And it did a full life cycle accounting of that and showed that it was a net carbon sink. So even including the methane that they're emitting, which is the main piece that people are like, oh, but livestock emit methane. They analyzed this, a full life cycle analysis. It is a net carbon sink because of how much they are sequestering down into the soil. Wow. There's also these methanotrophs, which are methane oxidizing bacterial species, basically little critters in the soil that if you have healthy soils, they eat the methane. That's like their fuel source. So even though cows emit methane and that's a problem, they're sequestering and oxidizing more into the soil than they give off. So it's a net benefit to the environment to have those animals there. And then they took that lifestyle, that life cycle analysis a step further, and they analyzed it to different protein sources. So they analyzed conventional beef, they analyzed poultry, pork. They also looked at the Impossible Burger and Beyond Meat, you know, all those faux meats that are coming out that everyone's like raving about. And like you go to a nice burger joint and you see Impossible Burger advertised and they're like, what the fuck?
No, I'll riot. I mean, like if...
No.
No, let me tell you.
Anyone ever tell you had the case of the Mondays?
No, I'd fucking get your ass kicked. I think if I went to a burger place, I'd be like on like the news, be like, this guy went to a burger place. They tried to give him fake meat. He rioted and burnt that place to the ground. That man was John Welbourn. I got no problem on that one.
So they compared the carbon emissions, a full carbon accounting for conventional beef. Conventional beef was a plus 33. So that's plus 33 CO2 equivalents per kilogram of meat. They looked at Beyond Meat. Beyond Meat was a plus 3.5. Impossible Burger was a +4. So all of these are still a net emitter. You know, they are destroying the environment. They are releasing more carbon into the atmosphere through their production. Like, that's just, they're a bad thing. They are a negative to the environment. And then White Oak Pastures, they're regeneratively raised with holistic management. Their beef was a net carbon sink, and it was the only protein source that is a net benefit to the environment compared to all these other things out there. So people can come out and say that the Impossible Burger and Beyond Meat and all these other things are a better solution compared to conventional beef. You know, a +3.5 is much better than a +33. It's causing a lot less damage. But we don't just need to move in the direction of doing less bad. We need to move in the direction of doing actual good. And regenerative agriculture is the only thing that's doing actual good and giving us hope for turning back the clock, you know, those 60 years of harvest left, of buying us more time so that we can have a better planet to leave for our future generations.
Fucking preach, Bobby. God damn, that's hot. I got goosebumps.
Shut it down. Let's go home.
That's it.
Dude, thanks for your time. Thanks for chatting with us. Appreciate
it. Thank you, gentlemen.
And Power Athlete Nation, get on it. Get on the Savory Institute. Get on the newsletter. Get on their social. Stay plugged in. We're an army that can help make this change. Let's fucking do it.
Yeah.
But other than that,
eat better meat.
Bye, Bobby.
Bye.
Oh, we're idiots.
Now it's time for you to empower your performance. Please check out www.savory.global for more information about the Savory Institute and how to get involved. You can also make a donation to this nonprofit organization and learn about how they've been utilizing the funds to educate farmers worldwide. Until next time, bye!